Now here's the rear, then the synthesis, and then skewing the harmonic. So we'll sort of hear as in the rainbow of harmonics, the successive harmonics separate. Now using it as elementary sounds, not sine waves, but gap or grains, this is the voice of Alex Grossman, one of the founders of the wavelet with Morley. Now stretched by Daniel Arfib, stretched or compressed in time without changing pitch.
G.
Constancy or invariance. It is a common observation that the sound source can be reliably identified over a variety of surfaces. A trumpet or a singing voice are readily identified as such, regardless of pitch or dynamics, and they remain recognizable even when heard over a distortion-ridden pocket-sized transistor radio. Thus, the question arises as to the physical correlates of this constancy. This relates to Denis Monnet's notion of source bonding. Is there a physical invariant or a characteristic feature mediating a given timbre? Well, this issue is important to understand how to evoke a given timbre by synthesis. One must be able to describe it in terms of a physical structure of the sound, which is what the program needs to make synthesis. Hence, the strategy of analysis by synthesis gives us a foolproof test. I just showed the relation that the relation between loudness and spectrum can evoke a brassy sound. Here is an additive synthesis imitation of the brass done by Ruhl, that is, the louder, the brighter. So it was a crescendo. Max Matthews built an electronic violin which sounds like a violin, but it's really done by, he played with a bow, but then with a mechanism that mimics the filtering effect of the box of the violin. Now, when I saw that, I suggested that he could put instead a voltage control filter that Moog had just manufactured to implement my rule of synthesis, the louder, the brighter. And so here is Max Matthews playing his violin with the bow, but with a Moog filter, and it doesn't really start like a violin. Oh, I'm sorry. When it's adjusted, it does sound like a violin. And here is a duet where one is the acoustic violin and one is the electronic violin. Okay, now the electronic violin was the first one which played, but it's fairly close. Now, by replacing the resonant filtering by the Moog filter, bandpass filter. Now, the question of simple versus multiple is crucial in sound synthesis. When several tones are heard together, will the ear interpret them as a single sonic entity or as several distinguishable sounds? This relates to our capacity for auditory scene analysis, as Bregman calls it. The answer is complex. The sense of hearing is well equipped to distinguish several simultaneous sounds, but certain configurations of simultaneous sounds favor their fusion. Harmonicity, some will tend to fuse if their frequency ratios are harmonic, proportional to 1, 2, 3, etc. Small spacing, and very important, common fate. These features are ecologically justified in the sense that they help the listener cope with his environment, his or her environment, and unravel many sonic components to distinguish between several sources of sound. Through analysis by synthesis, John Charlie has shown that simultaneous sound component can be heard as a unique sonic entity by imposing them a common fate, or as a multiplicity of sound by controlling minute differences between their behavior. He has then given a brilliant explanation of our capacity to distinguish two tones in unison. this understanding made him allowed him to make distinct voice emerge from the sonic magma in his work Folding. Maybe I'll play a couple of related examples here. First we have a single G, and after a few seconds it will sort of split into a low G, baritone-like, and G2, octaves above, soprano-like. This is inspired, this is a copy practically of John Charlie's demonstration. It's not,
implying that truth, morality and beauty
are relative to the human specificities. There are no external truths, eternal standards, or absolute canons. This opens the door to individualism. It also stresses the specificity and the importance of human perception. Plato, followed later by Descartes, despite the error of the senses, yet in spite of his idealistic point of view, our senses are our only window to the world, in addition, of course, to what we know. As Perkins wrote, sensory illusions are errors of the senses, but truths of perception. Now the computer permitted to manufacture, to demonstrate some illusions. For example, these are various sounds synthesized by computer, and these are images of sound spectrogram. It's clear that you can manufacture different morphologies. But if you look at this analysis, for example, this frequency versus time, you would think that perhaps you have several tones together, but they fuse, as I said before, and they fuse to give a strange descent. Of matters, solid, liquid, gases, and plasma. But since it will be played on Thursday, I'm not going to skip this example. I go to auditory illusions that, as I said, reveal the mechanism of hearing, and they can be obtained with the help of synthesis, which permits to control at will the physical structure of the sound. But what counts for music is a perceived effect. Here is from 1966, John Charling worked on illusory source motion. The speakers are fixed, but you have the impression that the sources move around. This is an example he realized a bit later, but in the 60s. Sound, and this is another example which this is an example of what is this, sort of looks like a spiral, but it's really concentric circles, so it's similar to the Shepard and endless glissando illusion. This is a sound which I made in analogy with this Escher fall that goes down but reaches a higher point. This goes down in pitch, but it's lower at the end than it's higher at the end and at the beginning. Now, still another illusion. Most people say that the first one is a little higher by about a semitone, but I go from the first one to the second one by doubling the speed of the tape recorder, which is not, of course, very intuitive. And this is done by track shock tape. So when you use unusual sounds, you can really get the surprising effects. And also, I did the same with rhythm, a sound that seemed to slow down when you double the speed of the tape recorder. And this is to really reinforce the notion that it's essential to understand about perception, because music is meant to be heard. Now, let's go briefly about, let's speak, So, you can say that music is anchored in us. The musical phenomenon only takes place within certain ranges. Our hearing limits its frequency span, of course, but also its rhythmic span. Music no longer sounds as musical when it when this increases or decreases frequencies or speeds by a factor of 4, for example. Echoing this relativism, Max Matthews reminded that man's ear should remain the measure of all things. Technology can produce an unlimited variety of sounds, but as he said, many of them are ugly, dangerous, or inaudible. Now, a few words about chaos. Otto Rosler considered that the inventor of chaos is a pre-Socratic philosopher Anaxagoras. Around 1970, Rosler, a chemist self-proclaimed specialist of non-specialization, exhibited impressive examples of chaotic dynamics, in particular a remarkable strange attractor with a fractal structure. Anaxagoras had imagined primordial chaos as a homogeneous mixture, a confused soup or milk containing all things. All things existed from the beginning, but they were undifferentiated and indistinguishable as tiny pieces that have to be separated. Mind or spirit, knows, could extricate the mixture, separate the like from the unlike, thus making the simple emerge out of the complex. Nutrition is a good example of the process of mixing and mixing. Anaxagoras also appears to have been aware of self-similarity, fractality, and eternal recurrence. Similar views exist in some cosmologies. At the end of the 19th century, Poincaré justified the idea of eternal recurrence independently evoked by Nietzsche. In the 20th century, self-organizing systems were evoked by Teilhard de Chardin and Ilya Prigogine. Such systems produce order from chaos. The idea of unmixing seems to be confirmed by recent theories of the Big Bang. Stravinsky viewed music as a construction instituting an order in things, especially between man and time. In the 1950s, information theory suggested that significant intelligible messages should have an information rate intermediary between order and disorder, periodicity and noise, predictability and unpredictability. Eyal Hiller proposed to use computer programs to extract order from a chaotic multitude of available possibilities, that's his own words. Xenakis composed stochastic music, in which he sought sometimes a minimal structuration for music, initially for the microstructure composition, then in GEMDIII for both microstructure and microstructure, for both syntax and vocabulary. Unmixing could be related to subtractive synthesis. The method consists of submitting a spectrally rich wave to a specific type of filtering, thus eliminating the unwanted element rather than assembling wanted ones. Subtractive synthesis is well adapted to certain type of sounds like voice or violin, as demonstrated by Matthews and Cohen. Anaxagoras' concept of unmixing is put to work in the powerful process of blind deconvolution developed by Paris, Magardis and others. This process permits to separate two voices mixed together in a stereo recording, for example, to get rid of the piano accompaniment in a stereo recording of a soprano lead recital. Chaotic phenomena have taken considerable importance in contemporary science. It imposes several severe limits to predictability. Even simple dynamic systems may have chaotic behavior. Dynamic systems are characterized by their attractors, kind of out-time multidimensional representation. Chaotic systems have strange attractors with a fractal structure. The dialectic between order and chaos reminds of the debate between Parmenides and Heraclitus. Creativity seems possible only at the frontier of order and chaos. The figures of chaos have inspired music. Nicolas Darbon has written a book on the music of chaos. I myself used it more or less metaphorically in a piece, as here's a brief passage en route to chaos at the end of my work Pentac for harpsichord and computer.
About Plato and New Atlantis,
But I shall skip this since we have a round table on Plato.
Tomorrow.
And then, so I will go to conclusions. And I have bravely ventured on philosophical grounds, but I feel a bit uneasy about it. And I want to refer to a monumental treatise about concepts at work in Western music, Mathematics et Subjectivité, written by Hugues Dufour, a remarkable French composer and philosopher. John Charling and I can testify that since 1974, Dufour has commented important issues of musical informatics with a deep and encouraging understanding. Now, Dufour suggests in his book that contemporary music highlights what was rejected in the antique Greek world. It rather captures the evanescent, the ephemeral, the ambivalent, the erroneous. It favors the endless metamorphosis of qualities and form. As Nietzsche proclaimed, Western music tends toward the liberation of the dionysiac dimension and the acceptance of the inacceptable part of myth. I want to mention a philosophical question implicit in the preoccupation of the antique Greek philosophers, a question that was asked by the Gelka psychologist Kurt Kofka in 1935. Does the world appear to us the way it does because it is the way it is, or because we are the way we are? Now, to this question, Roger Shepherd gave in 1981 this qualified answer. Well, the world appears the way it does because we are the way we are. Indeed, we do not see infrared, we do not hear ultrasounds, we do not have a sharp sense of smell of dogs. But we are the way we are because we have a world, we have evolved in a world that is the way it is. Shemart commented this, evolution has caused living being to internalize certain physical laws since it favored survival. Such a statement is fully supported by the understanding of hearing gained by the exploration of digital sound synthesis and processing. This understanding can be helpful to explore new sonic territories. However, sensory validity is not a sufficient criterion of aesthetic success. Faithful to external models, to mathematics or formalism, is not either a sufficient criterion of aesthetic success. The speculative vision of antique Greek philosophers about chaos, atoms, elements, flux, have found amazing confirmation in modern science, although their brains were tuned to the physical world. Recently, the mathematician Alain Cohn and the neurologist Jean-Pierre Changeux argued, were mathematics discovered or invented? Cohn, the mathematician, believes that mathematical objects exist independently of man, while Changeux believes that they are construction of the human brain. To some extent, the human brain is the way it is because it has evolved in a world that is the way it is. This suggests that one should not seek refuge in either formalism or empiricism in mathematical or perceptual justification. One must rather endeavor to reconcile these antagonistic attitudes in unpredictable way. Creation must assume the uncertainty of wandering in unmapped territories. Computing sound and music is still an odyssey. Thank you.
which makes this connection of modern computer music and sound technologies to ancient Greek philosophy. I think that it will remain in history. And we invite all of you tomorrow to the Academy of Plato, the people that don't play in the concerts, because we have a satellite event, and there is a lot to speak for 10 minutes about Plato's Atlantis and the impact of the concept music and mathematics in Timaeus of Plato in modern music. So we continue with questions. We have 5-7 minutes for questions. And yes, if you have any questions, otherwise we continue to the post session. No? So thank you very, very much again, Jean-Claude Risset.